Good evening. I'm Dave Alexander. I'm the Community Engagement Specialist for MLive Muskegon Chronicle. And welcome to Vision Muskegon Lake 2020. MLive is pleased to promote this community dialogue on one of our, if not maybe our most significant asset, Muskegon Lake. Historically, currently, and most importantly going forward, Muskegon Lake is such a vital part of our identity, of our quality of life, and our prosperity. In 2012, MLive did a year-long look at the importance of our water and its resources in a series called Water Runs Through Us. Muskegon Lake became a focal point of our investigation. Thank you for being here tonight, and join us in the next three activities that we'll be doing similar to this here at this location again tomorrow night, and we'll announce those before the evening's over with. And be free to be open with your thoughts, your ideas, and opinions. We need everyone to reach a community consensus here on our lake. And with that, I'd like to introduce and have come up Kathy Evans from West Michigan Shoreline Regional Development Commission.
Welcome, everyone. Very happy to see you here today at the Muskegon Lake Vision 2020. My name is Kathy Evans, and I'm the Environmental Program Manager at the West Michigan Shoreline Regional Development Commission. And the Regional Commission has programs in the areas of economic development, environment and natural resources, recreation, homeland security, local government services, transportation. We have GIS mapping, so we have a real diverse program all under one roof, and so real appropriate for us to be coordinating these events that touch on natural resources and the environment, recreation, residential, and commercial port activities for the lake. So thank you for being here. I know there's a lot of things you could be doing on a nice summer night, so we'll move things right along. Tonight, we're focused on the environment and natural resources. And the plan for this is to get your input tonight after hearing from an expert presenter on this subject matter. And then the Regional Commission will pull together the results of your input, and we will form a document, maybe some visual mapping in it, and some of your recommendations, because we're really trying to uncover the vision for Muskegon Lake that you know, and we need to know what that is. So as a community, we can share that document publicly, and hopefully everybody who has a stake in Muskegon Lake will find it useful in guiding how they do more specific planning for Muskegon Lake for the kinds of projects that will help us realize all of the benefits that Muskegon Lake has to offer. So the process should last throughout the summer, and by November we'll have a draft document for feedback, and in December we'll roll out the final product. So because each of the forums is very specific in topic and focus, the challenge for you is going to be to look at the lake and try to think about how we could come together and integrate all of these different uses and have a sustainable outcome for each of them and for the lake as a whole. Back in 1974, the Regional Commission pulled together a plan and a study of the lake, and we did a perceptions survey of attitudes about Muskegon Lake. And what's interesting is that back in 1974, we had just brought the Muskegon County Wastewater Management System online, and Muskegon Lake was visibly much improved. It was getting much better. And so people at that time were very interested in the future of the shoreline and what we were going to do and how we were going to develop it. And I think we're in a similar place again now, years later, where we have done a lot of cleanup of contaminated sediments, a lot of habitat restoration, but we're in a place still where we want to know what the future is for the shoreline in more of the era of a blue economy. So there are some similarities, and we hope to actually bring out a similar survey again, and that'll be another piece of gathering information that you'll hear more about later this summer. So, not to take any more time on the process right now, first I think the most interesting thing is for us to hear from our speaker tonight. Dr. Alan Steinman is with us, and he is the director of the Annis Water Resources Institute and professor of water resources at Grand Valley State University. For the past 14 years, Dr. Steinman has led a team of scientists and researchers through the Institute's Water Resources Program, and we are fortunate that they are located right here on Muskegon Lake in Muskegon, Michigan. Currently, Al is a member of science advisory boards for the U.S. Environmental Protection Agency, the International Joint Commission, Michigan Department of Environmental Quality, Sea Grant, Healing Our Waters, University of Michigan's Water Center, and others. I knew when to cut it off. Okay. Al also has served on the State of Michigan's Groundwater Conservation Advisory Council and Phosphorus Advisory Committees. His research interests include aquatic ecosystem restoration, harmful algal blooms, this is good stuff, phosphorus cycling, and water policy. In April 2015, Al released a report, brand new, that he co-authored with John Austin on Michigan's blue economy. Do you want me to go into the PhDs?
No.
Okay. All right. Al's current community service, though, I think is very important, and he it includes serving on the board of directors of the Michigan chapter of the Nature Conservancy, Goodwill Industries of West Michigan, and the Community Foundation for Muskegon County. So please join me in welcoming Al Steinman.
Thank you, Kathy, for inviting me to present, and I'm going to start off with a very short history of Muskegon Lake, because in order to understand its current condition, we really have to put it in the context of its historical use. And so I think most of us know that back during the lumber industry, back in the late 19th century, we had 47 active sawmills at its peak on Muskegon Lake. And so as a consequence, there are some legacies associated with those sawmills, including mill debris, sawdust, and those legacies continue today. After the lumber industry went bust, the industrial activities started in the early 20th century on Muskegon Lake, particularly on the south shoreline. On the left, you can see downtown Muskegon back in, this is an aerial from 1932, looking at Continental Motor Works, which is actually where we're sitting right now in Merrick. And then there was direct dumping in Muskegon Lake back in the mid-20th century, and direct discharge of effluent. Kathy mentioned that when the Muskegon County Wastewater Management System went online in 1974, a lot of this effluent was redirected away from the lake towards the wastewater treatment facility, and that has accounted for a considerable amount of the improvement in Muskegon Lake's water quality. But when you look at these activities comprehensively, we can look at the fact that with the industrial activities, with the lumber mills, this yellow area represents the amount of open Muskegon Lake that has been filled in over time. That's 16% of the open water that has been filled in. If you took that surface area, that 16%, you coalesced it into a new lake, the surface area would be larger than 95% of the inland lakes in the state of Michigan. That's how much we filled in Muskegon Lake. So that's a pretty amazing amount of habitat that has been altered on the lake itself. So with that context, I want to talk about several of the natural resource features on the lake, starting off with water quality. Back in when I first came, when the Institute first moved to Muskegon from Allendale in 2001, we started a long-term monitoring program on Muskegon Lake with support from the community, with support from the Community Foundation for Muskegon County. This long-term monitoring program will go on for perpetuity because we have the endowment fund in place. And our goals were twofold: to observe the long-term and short-term health changes in the ecological health of the lake, and then use this information to delist Muskegon Lake as one of the 43 areas of concern in the Great Lakes. I think we all know that White Lake was delisted last fall, and hopefully Muskegon Lake will be delisted in the next 5 years. But in order to delist, we have to show the EPA and the Department of Environmental Quality with scientifically defensible information that the lake's health has improved. So what we do is, on a quarterly basis, we go out to these six sites in blue, the blue circles, just where the Muskegon River comes in to Muskegon Lake, where the Bear Lake flows in from the channel into Muskegon Lake, where the navigation channel flows out to Lake Michigan, the deep hole in Muskegon Lake, which is about 74 feet, where Rudderman Creek flows out into the lake, and then just off of AWRI's site. And we go out there on a quarterly basis and measure water quality. In addition, we go to these four red squares and monitor fish on a quarterly basis. And then we also have a zebra and quagga mussel site at the Institute where we monitor changes in the mussel populations. And then we compare these to the historical data that were collected in 1972 by the EPA before the Clean Water Act was approved. So we can compare how the lake's water quality has changed over time as a function of these kinds of activities that we've been doing as part of restoration. And then in 2010, we got funding to put a observatory, a water quality observatory, or a buoy, in Muskegon Lake, and this relates real-time data back to us on what's going on through the 40 feet of water in the lake, and I'll show you those data in a minute.
For years, people have put together photo collages for special occasions. They go through the photo album and old shoe boxes and pull out their favorite photos and put them on poster boards. The boards are a great way of sharing stories, but it can be a pretty tedious job. Well, we here at Clox, we want to make that job easier for you. So just bring us all the photos and we'll scan them into the computer, and then we'll print out the collages on our large format printer. That way, all the photos will be in digital format so you can share them with your friends and relatives.
Living healthy is more than just counting carbs and exercising, it's a lifestyle choice. Embrace sound, natural alternatives, cultivate and sustain a better way to healthy living. The Health Hut offers a wide selection of vitamins, minerals, herbs, medicinal mushrooms, women's and men's supplements, as well as a vast array of skincare and beauty products. Their friendly, knowledgeable staff is always on hand to help you choose the products that best suit your individual needs. The Health Hut. We have your good health in mind.
With four convenient locations, Jack's Corner Store is one-stop shopping at its best. Tools, fresh meats, produce, chips, snacks, and other grocery items, beer, wine, and liquor, even gas and lottery. That's why Jack's is your corner store and so much more.
In the 150 years we've been in business, many things have changed. Our greatest achievements are rooted in the things that haven't. Years ago, the person you called banker was also the person you called friend. When it came to service, there were fewer layers and friendlier smiles. And banks earned the trust of their customers and community while working tirelessly not to lose it. At Independent Bank, all this remains true today. Sure, we've made advances that help customers bank more conveniently and more comfortably. But at the end of the day, we know that people really need a trustworthy partner committed to their financial goals, dreams, and aspirations. And we've been happy to be that partner since 1864.
Glenside and Northside Pubs, from sandwiches, burgers, and Mexican food to starters, salads, soups, and desserts, not to mention their specialty pizzas like Hawaiian, vegetarian, chicken Alfredo, and of course their grand finale. It's the Glenside and Northside Pubs.
Hi, I'm Brenda Harris with Nexus Realty, turning dreams into an address. I support DSE TV.
We take this information and we try and put it in a very digestible format, in this case in a dashboard, where green is good, yellow is somewhere in between, and red is bad. And this is for total phosphorus, so we're looking at the actual units don't make a difference, but you want to see that in 2014 our phosphorus concentrations were in the green area, which is good. The lower the phosphorus, the better, up until a certain point, because with less phosphorus you get less algal growth. Now, we don't want the phosphorus to get too low, because if it's very, very low, you're not going to have any growth in the lake at all, and then your fish populations are going to go kaput, and that's not good. So to put this in context, we can go out into Lake Michigan. The total phosphorus concentrations in Lake Michigan now are about 2 micrograms per liter, right? That's really low. That's as low as Lake Superior. You can go down to Lake Makatawa. Anybody know what Lake Makatawa's total phosphorus concentrations are? Rick can't answer.
30 or 40.
Keep going. It's one of the most nutrient-rich lakes in the state. It's 130 on average, all right? Okay, so we're doing pretty well, relatively speaking, right? And we can take this information, we can look at it in historical context, not just what happened this past year, but what's happened over time. So here's 1972, and we can see in Muskegon Lake, we were at 60. And now, since we've been monitoring the lake in 2003, we've continued to go down, and we're in this desirable range right now. So that's good news. And we do this for a number of water quality parameters. I'm not going to show them all to you, because your eyes will glaze over, but I do want to highlight a few of the most critical ones. So we know that phosphorus controls algae. So the next one is looking at chlorophyll. Chlorophyll is a pigment. It's got a very strong relationship with the amount of algae present. So when chlorophyll is high, algae is high as well. And we can see we want to be below 10 micrograms per liter. And we can see in 2014, we were about 3. That's really good. In Lake Michigan, we're less than 1. In Lake Makatawa, we're about 40. Right? So that gives you the context that we have. And historically, we can see Muskegon Lake was almost 25 back in 1972 when we had really high phosphorus concentrations. And since then, we've had a couple of blips, but we're down in the desirable phase now, which is good news, right? We want some algae because it's the base of the food web, but we don't want so low an amount that we don't have enough to sustain the fishery in Muskegon Lake. And we don't want to have so much that it's a aesthetic problem or a recreational problem. Now, we also are concerned about water clarity. We want clear water. And so what we do is we take this Secchi disc, it's a black and white disc, and we put it in the water, and when we can no longer tell the difference between the black and white wedges, that's our Secchi disc depth. And we're hoping, in this case, we want a higher number, because the deeper the water it is before we see this difference means that the water is clearer and clearer. Lake Tahoe, the Secchi disc depth is about somewhere between 30 and 40 meters, all right? Lake Makatawa, it's less than half a meter. Again, putting it in context. And we're just below the goal that we hope. Now, keep in mind that Muskegon Lake is never going to be Lake Tahoe. It's never going to be Crystal Lake. It's got natural staining of the waters from tannins from decaying vegetation. So it's never going to be really, really clear, even if there was absolutely no growth in the lake. So this is probably a reasonable amount that we have here. And then historically, again, back when we had large amounts of algae, you're going to have very little clarity because of the algal growth, and we were at less than 1.5 meters. And since then, we've been averaging about 2 meters. It's not bad. And then finally, dissolved oxygen concentrations. We want high DO. That's what the fish need for the kind of fish we want. And this is the percentage of time that the dissolved oxygen concentration was less than 2 milligrams per liter in the bottom of Muskegon Lake, right? Less than 2 milligrams per liter is what we call the hypoxic zone. It's what the media refer to as the dead zone, but it's not dead, Dave, so please don't report it that way. It just has growth. It has, just like the Gulf of Mexico, they talk about the dead zone. It's not dead. There's biological life there. It's just not the life we want. It's a lot of bacteria, a lot of decomposers, but there's stuff going on there. But we don't want that low DO concentration. We want it to be higher. Now, in 2014, it was less than 2 milligrams between May and October, about 8% of the time, which is desirable. We want to make sure it's not more than 10 to 20% of the time. And if we look at the data, this is our buoy data. So the buoy went online in 2011, so this is 4 years of data. We can see in 2011 and 2012, we actually had almost a third of the time between May and October, Muskegon Lake and the bottom waters in the middle of the lake went below 2 milligrams per liter. And as you'll see in a second, it actually went down to zero on lots of occasions. That is problematic. And we don't know what's causing that. We don't know if that's natural. We don't know if that's something because of more nutrients in the system, that it occurs as a function of this nutrient enrichment. And we don't know if this occurs in other drowned river mouth systems. This is something we need to investigate because we've only seen these data in the last few years. We had no idea this occurred. So this is from the buoy data. And here I'm showing you, we have sensors throughout the entire 40 feet of water. So blue is near the surface, black is at the bottom. And look at here, there's the 2 milligram per liter hypoxic zone line, and the black is at the bottom. And you can see in the summer months, in 2011 and 2012, we went down to near zero for a sustained period of time. So the fish can't survive there. They're going to migrate out into the shore areas, what we call the littoral zones. And they can survive by swimming, but other critters that can't swim aren't going to have that same advantage. And when they go out to those near shore zones, that may not be their preferred habitat. So we don't know if we're stressing them by moving away from where they prefer to be out into the near shore areas. This is the kind of research that we need to do in the future. And we don't know how much of a problem this is. But in general, we can talk about the water quality in Muskegon Lake improving with this one caveat. Now, we also look at the quagga and zebra mussels. Now, the genus is Dreissena, so we call them Dreissenid mussels. Most people are familiar with zebra mussels. Zebra mussels are almost gone from Lake Michigan. They have been replaced by their cousin, the quaggas, which are actually, they can grow deeper, they can grow on both soft and hard substrates. They're like the zebras on steroids. They're a little more problematic. And we've been monitoring how much they grow. It's hard to see here, but there's little mussels on these substrates that we place in this cage off of AWRI. And if we look at the densities, this is single year, starting in 2004 up to 2014. Our densities started off at about 18,000 individuals per meter squared, 3 by 3, right? That's a lot. But it's gone down over time. And then we have plates that we leave out for 2 years, for 3 years, and for 4 years. And we're out there for 4 years. There are about 25,000 of these zebra mussels and quagga mussels per meter squared. And that sounds horrific, but compare, put them in context. Here's the data I just showed you in Muskegon Lake. All right, this is Saginaw Bay right after the zebra mussels invaded the Great Lakes. We were at 250,000 per meter squared. So relative to that, it's not so bad, but it's certainly cause for concern. And we have other invasive species in Muskegon Lake, just like throughout the rest of the Great Lakes, which we need to be aware of with respect to our natural resources. The round goby is an invasive fish that's come in. And in fact, it's the fish that we have the highest numbers of. Not biomass, because they're small, but in terms of sheer numbers, there's more round gobies than any other fish in Muskegon Lake. They don't have any recreational value. They're displacing a lot of the sculpin that's in the lake. They like hard substrates. And so we're concerned about the amounts of round goby that have come in. We have cattail, we have phragmites that we're concerned about, and then we have these Dreissenid mussels. In addition, Muskegon Lake, I'm not particularly proud to say, has been the site of two new species identified, invasive species found in the Great Lakes for the first time. They were found for the first time in the Great Lakes in Muskegon Lake. There's this blue-green alga. It's a potentially harmful alga called Cylindra spermopsis. It has the potential to release the toxin Cylindra spermopsin, but we haven't seen it yet released by this species in Muskegon Lake, but it does have the potential to do that. It's a subtropical species. It shouldn't be in the Great Lakes, but because of warming of the region and warming of the lakes, we think it now can survive in these lakes over winter in these, like, they form these spores, and then when the temperatures get high enough, they germinate. In addition, Steve Pothoven at NOAA's Great Lakes Environmental Research Field Station on the channel found the bloody red shrimp hemimysis for the first time in the Great Lakes a few years ago. So this is something to consider when we're talking about port activity. Now, port activity has tremendous opportunity for economic growth in this region, but it also has the potential to introduce invasive species. And it's these competing demands, for what the society wants from these kinds of activities, that really is the hallmark of these kinds of visioning sessions. And so as you go to recreation, as you go to port activity, as you go to the socio and economic activities, think about these competing demands for all of these different activities and where your social values lie. Because there's no right answer here. There's no right or wrong answer. It's a matter of trying to balance these competing demands, which is not an easy thing to do.
Beginning as a lumber company in 1911, Frederick's Construction has been servicing the Muskegon area since 1969. Family owned and operated, they specialize in roofing, siding, windows, insulation, additions, doors, decks, and more. Located at 1940 Commerce Street in beautiful downtown Muskegon, their phone number is 231-722-3937. When you want quality workmanship, you want Frederick's Construction.
Muskegon. My name is Mark DeWitt. I'm the owner here at RPM Automotive. We've been here since 1996. We're a full-service auto repair center. We do both foreign and domestic repairs. Most of our repairs are performed same day. We do everything from AC, engine repair, and computer diagnostics. Feel free to call or come by and see us. We're located on Getty Street next to the Getty Street Grill.
The Village at Park Terrace Senior Living Community, offering beautiful yet affordable one and two bedroom apartment homes as well as two bedroom cottages. Rent includes a wide variety of exceptional services, from daily meals shared in the dining room or delivered to your door, to scheduled activities and social events, to 24-hour emergency on-call service. Their expert, caring staff is there to assist you with all of your retirement needs. The Village at Park Terrace Senior Living Community, where you can enjoy the luxuries and comfort of your own home without the work and worry.
Sitting Pretty Pet Spa and Boutique is a full grooming salon with a wide range of services for dogs, cats, even birds, rabbits, guinea pigs, and ferrets. Their spa treatments include mud baths, facials, coat damage and repair, aromatherapy, de-shedding, teeth brushing, and paw repair and massage. Doesn't your best friend deserve a special spa day?
Dive!
Green board.
Emergency dive, 300 feet.
300 feet, aye, sir.
Sir, splash of water, depth charges.
All hands, battle stations.
The second general area I want to talk about was shoreline habitat. We did a survey back in 2004. We went around the entire lake and we mapped the shoreline. So hardened surfaces represent seawall, riprap. It's really good for boating, right? Because you have a nice secure shoreline. It's really poor habitat for biota. The natural habitat is usually softened. It's got a natural slope, and that's a good thing. But you can see back in 2004, almost two-thirds of Muskegon Lake shoreline was hardened, right? And that was the impetus for the stimulus money that Kathy got in 2010 to restore almost 10,000 linear feet of shoreline in Muskegon Lake along the south shore largely. And what we did was we took areas that looked like this, Heritage Landing, before the restoration, and turned it into this post-restoration. So basically, you're taking habitat that was really bad and turning it into habitat that's very good. It's good for wildlife. As it goes down into the water, you're creating the vegetation. That's good habitat for the bugs. When it's good for the bugs, it's good for the fish. When the fish come back, the people come back. Right? So all of this has this cascading positive impact. And this is just the planting that was done as part of this activity as well, to get the natural vegetation back on the shoreline. Other examples of pre and post restoration, as you can see here on Grand Trunk, we have activities like this. There's actually a downed log here, and some people might think that that's poor aesthetics, but this woody debris, as we like to call it, is actually really good habitat. It's a habitat for the invertebrates and for the fish. They like that structure. They like that protection. So having downed logs can be very positive, not so much for navigation, but it's good for habitat. And some other examples that go on along the Lakeshore Trail, where that 10,000 linear feet was restored from having a lot of crud to something that is actually quite beautiful, quite aesthetically pleasing, and also really important shoreline habitat for our biota. So we talk about the wetland habitat. One of the things that we do is we develop these indices of biotic integrity. I know it's a fancy term. IBI is a lot easier to recall. IBI is just a simple way of taking a lot of information and collapsing it into one number. And the higher the number, the healthier the ecosystem, the lower the number, the more degraded the ecosystem is. And we do this for vegetation, we do this for invertebrates, we do this for fish. And what we've been doing is we've been monitoring a whole series of these drowned river mouth coastal wetlands up and down the coast here on the west side of Michigan. These were data that were generated by one of my grad students, Matt Cooper, and other colleagues at AWRI. And we would sample the submerged aquatic vegetation. This is really important, the SAV, as we call it, because it's important habitat for the fish and bugs. And so we like SAV as long as it's not invasive submerged aquatic vegetation. And here you can see the actual score doesn't make much difference, but look how Muskegon compares to Pentwater, which is a pretty pristine system. It compares very favorably. So with respect to submerged aquatic vegetation, our vegetation in Muskegon Lake is doing pretty darn well. And we just monitored this a few years ago, and it continues to do well as part of the post-restoration activities, as part of that shoreline habitat work, particularly compared to Kalamazoo. We do the same thing with fish. We want an IBI that exceeds 36 in Muskegon Lake. And Muskegon Lake is the tan line here, shown here. And you can see that Muskegon Lake, since 2004, has continued to be far in excess of that 36. So our fish populations also, with respect to this IBI score, are doing very, very well. We also monitor the fish on spike nets as part of that long-term monitoring program. We place these spike nets overnight, and we come up with results as catch per net night. I'm not going to overwhelm you with fish data, but I do want to show you data from the last 3 years for the spring, summer, and fall, so you get an idea of the kind of fish that we're catching. Now, I want to point out that this bias is towards smaller shoreline fish, because it's near the littoral zone that I was talking about. So you're not going to see sturgeon caught in a fike net, but you are going to see some of the smaller fish. So here's the spring data from 2012 through 2014. And you can see in the spring, we get a lot of round goby. The round goby, like a cooler, as it starts to warm up, the goby move offshore. But that's not necessarily a good thing. We also get rock bass through these years. And then we've had a couple of good age classes for yellow perch. You'll see in the summer, this yellow perch from the spring moved into the summer months. And then the other stuff is variable depending year to year. In the summer, the yellow perch have started to come on here. We also get some largemouth bass in every year in the summer and some bluegills as well. But the bluegill tend to do the best in the fall, as you can see here. And then you will either get some small minnows, some small killifish as well. And then the perch continue to do well as they move on into the fall as they continue to mature. So that gives you a general idea. We also do electrofishing in the lake to look at the larger fish. I'm not going to talk about those data. But I just want to wrap up by mentioning the fact that, you know, we are concerned about the iconic fish like sturgeon. Muskegon Lake and Muskegon River watershed is one of the best habitats for sturgeon rearing in Michigan, and we want to make sure we keep that. The sturgeon are particularly impacted by the dissolved oxygen concentrations that we have here. That's Kathy's next slide. In Muskegon Lake, so that's of concern as well as we try and create the habitat and preserve the habitat for good fishing in Muskegon Lake. So with that, I am going to turn it back over to Kathy and hopefully get an overview of this.
So now we get to start giving our input. Al's presentation went over a lot of the background on the status of the natural resource assets of Muskegon Lake. So basically, the assets that we're talking about under the natural resources category are the surface water, fish and wildlife habitat, wetlands, the terrestrial shoreline, which is the upland shoreline near the water, the drier part of the shoreline. And then the aquatic and near shore resources, plant life, animal life, water. And what we will be doing today is using our polling software, and you should all have one of your clickers, to assess the amount, distribution, aesthetics, and the accessibility of natural resources assets. The criteria we will use is strongly agree, neutral, disagree, and strongly disagree, and you may notice that those are numbered, and on your clickers there are some numbers. And so when we get to the polling slides, we'll ask that you correspond with that. Now, I want to just preface this with some of these questions you may feel, well, I don't know, I'm not an expert, I'm not sure exactly what is meant, but don't worry because I think you'll do pretty well. And you'll have plenty of time to give very specific input and to even give us your questions that can be answered later following the polling session, because we will be moving on to breakout stations. There are four stations at the corners of this room, and we are later going to count off in fours, and we're going to rotate around the room, and that'll be your chance to ask those questions. If you aren't sure, we'll write those down, we'll get back to you, and also a chance for you to just give very specific input about locations, amounts, you know, very specific. So right now we'll start with this question. Muskegon Lakes natural resources adequately add to the area's scenic beauty. And I don't want to lead you in any one direction, but I know when we ran through this with staff earlier, you know, people thought, well, you know, there may be room for improvement, there may not be, so it's pretty straightforward. Currently, right now, the way things are today, I think that's what had to be clarified. Do Muskegon Lakes natural resources adequately add to the area's scenic beauty today? The way things are now. So, I see we have 47 responses, 49, 50. How many do we have in the room, Mary? Do you have a count?
About 67.
67.
How many times can we vote?
Oh, and you can vote as many times as you want to, but the last vote will count. So really wants, but if you want to change your mind while the polling is still open, you can do that. We have 58 responses so far. Yes.
The question adequately. Does it mean that you think the resources are, you strongly agree that they're as good as they can be, or do you think it's important, or do you think they are very important? I don't quite understand.
Well, what we thought when we ran through it with staff was that, you know, if there's room for improvement, I don't think you want to say that you strongly agree that they're adequate. You might want to say something less than that if you think there's room for improvement. I think that's what I was trying to explain before. So, So you can change your answers now. Let's see. 59 responses. If there's still people who need to reply, we'll give you about 10 seconds. Counting down. All right, I think we're in pretty good shape. All right, so good results there. We have 24% strongly agree, 39% agree, 20% are neutral, 12% disagree, and 5% strongly disagree. Now our next question, the amount of natural resources in and around Muskegon Lake is sufficient. Same idea. You know, if you think there's room for improvement, you don't want to.
Can you define natural resources?
The natural resources are the water, the fish, the wildlife, the plant life, all of the natural resource assets that we discussed that Al provided information on, the sand, everything that we have that is natural. In the lake bottom, in the water itself, and around that shoreline that is very near the water's edge. All right, we're doing good. 56 responses, just a few more to go. 57, that's a tough one. And so, if you don't answer, that's fine. We'll take that as being maybe like a could not judge or something like that. Okay. We don't want a lot of those, so we want you to try. So, the answers. All right. We have 7% strongly agree that the amount of natural resources around Muskegon Lake is sufficient. 28% agree, 19% are neutral, 42% disagree, and 4% strongly disagree.
McDonald's Candies, 1064 South Getty Street in Muskegon, features an assortment of chocolate-covered nuts and creams, peanut clusters, fudge, seafoam, turtles, cherry cordials, and regular and holiday novelties.
Northway Lane, 1751 Evanston Avenue in Muskegon, featuring 50 auto score lanes, cosmic bowling, billiards, a cafe and banquet facility, lounge and pro shop. Looking for somewhere to hold your child's next birthday party? Northway Lanes can supply everything you need, from invitations and decorations, to personal pizzas, hot dogs and fries, to soft drinks, ice cream and goodie bags, even a private party room.
At Langlois Home Furnishing in Muskegon, we've been serving West Michigan for over 65 years. Langlois is a local family-owned store with national buying power. We carry the largest selection of mattresses from Serta in West Michigan. Plus, we can help with design ideas. We also have a great selection of the latest top brand appliances and HD TVs. Discover what's new for you at Langlois Home Furnishings on Henry Street in Muskegon.
The Health Hut, located at 3112 Henry Street in Norton Shores, offers a full line of natural and organic groceries, including fresh produce and free-range, hormone-free meats, eggs, cheese, and dairy provided by local farms. Taking pride in carrying products which contain no preservatives, additives, or unhealthy fats, their wide selection of allergen-free foods can accommodate most specialty diets. From frozen desserts and entrees to pastas, baking mixes and cereals, to soups and salad dressings, to chips, candy, and other snacks, The Health Hut. We have your good health in mind.
For nearly 9 years, West Michigan Driving Academy has been providing Muskegon County with complete, comprehensive driver's education. Students spend time both in the classroom and on the road in a state-approved driver's education vehicle with state-certified instructors. West Michigan Driving Academy is the only school in Muskegon that offers both day and evening classes throughout the summer. Accident-free, with 150 years of combined experience, you will drive safe at West Michigan Driving Academy.
I've had dozens of people tell me, just cremate me when I die and then throw a big party. I'm sure you've heard someone say that too. I completely get it. Well, I want to help you throw that party. I've got tables and chairs and easels and boards. I've got sound systems and music. I've got caterers and food. And I've got all the people to set it up and break it down when it's all over. So why don't you let us here at Clocks help you with that party so you can focus on what's important, sharing the stories.
Upland and aquatic habitat areas are sufficiently connected. You may remember when Al Steinman discussed how the in-the-water vegetation and life there and the upland plant life and shoreline habitat connection is important. Sometimes you might see a shoreline area, an upland area that has a seawall and it's not connected to that nice graded shoreline interface. So what we're asking about here are, do you think we have enough places where that connection is there, is present? So Muskegon Lake's natural upland and aquatic habitat areas are sufficiently connected. And for that matter, are they connected in and of themselves within the lake and are the upland habitats also connected? Because that's a very important thing for wildlife, so that they can travel and use the area as habitat for all different portions of their life cycles. Many of you probably know, you know, that a frog may need the water for laying eggs, but they need the upland area for another portion of their life. So, you know, we have places on Muskegon Lake where there are connected and contiguous habitats, aquatic and terrestrial, and then we have places where it's not. But this is a statement that we need to assess whether or not what we do have is sufficient.
We saw a couple of examples of the restoration projects. Mm-hmm. How many do we have of those?
Yeah. About 15, and we're probably at about 50, under probably 15,000 feet of softened shoreline. What was the hardened shoreline? We had a percentage up there, but I don't know how many feet were hardened.
No, I can look that up, but we went from about 65%, and currently I think we're right about 52%.
Yeah, that's right. That's right. We're at 52%. Okay, so. One more, and then we'll finish the poll.
That was the slide where you had the yellow and the black lines around the lake showing which was hard and which was soft.
Yes, and that study that Anniswater Resources Institute did told us that we had 64% of the shoreline that was hardened. And that meant it was disconnected, in some places worse than others, but disconnected from the open water aquatic and, you know, wetland areas. So the habitat restoration that we've been doing over the last several years has helped improve that situation. We haven't reached our goal yet, but we are working on that. So we have 4% strongly agree that Muskegon Lake's natural upland and aquatic habitat areas are sufficiently connected. 14% agree, 32% are neutral, 39% disagree, and 12% strongly disagree. Muskegon Lake's natural resources are available to residents and visitors. Okay, we're at 56, 57, 58, and we'll close the polling. So 16% strongly agree and 53% agree that Muskegon Lake's natural resources are available to residents and visitors. Now, we have a set of three questions that are going to give us a little more information about where the three other forum topics intersect with natural resources. And the other three forum topics have to do with residential, commercial port, and recreational development. So, additional shoreline residential development would have a positive effect on natural resources. And you can choose from these five answers. And we are at 57 responses. All right, so we have 4% strongly agree, 12% agree that additional shoreline residential development would have a positive effect on natural resources. 23% neutral, 35% disagree, 26% strongly disagree. And again, please give us more detailed input on what you're thinking, and if there's something we should do, let us know what it is. What do you recommend? Additional recreational development would have a positive effect on natural resources. So now we're looking at recreational development and how that would affect the natural resource assets of Muskegon Lake. Responses. All right, so we have in the middle there 32% agree, 30% neutral, and 23% disagree. So that's an interesting comparison. Additional commercial port development on Muskegon Lake would have a positive effect on natural resources. And this is the last of those statements where we judge how things intersect with natural resources. And please, I also urge you to come to the other forums. This is the first of four, and you're going to learn a lot more about what port development on a Muskegon Lake might look like. You'll learn more about recreation and residential plans for the future, too, because we'll have expert presenters at all of those forums as well, telling us more about the current status and the plans for those different topics. Okay, we're at 56. All right, so it looks like we have 43% disagree, 30% strongly disagree, leaning that way. So I really urge you to come to the port meeting, listen and hear more about what the future port activities could be. It may be different than, you know, your grandma's port. But just come and hear about what the plans are for the future in that area. Okay. So this is a statement that came up. We've received some input from the Muskegon Lake Watershed Partnership, which is the group that oversees and makes plans to clean up and restore Muskegon Lake. This is one of the statements they thought should be assessed. The sustainability of Muskegon Lake's natural resource assets is a local responsibility. We're not saying it is. We want you to assess this. That was something we wanted to assess. So, again, these statements aren't to be taken that these are the truth or these are what we think are right. This is just the way they're worded so they can be assessed properly. So we have 49, 50 responses so far. 55. Ooh, 59. Whoa, suddenly somebody else came online. We have 60. All right. Strongly agree and agree. I think that's great myself. But we'll see. We need our state and federal partners, but we need to take responsibility for what we value here as a community, too. So, quickly, we'll get through some demographic questions, and then we're going to move around and get a chance to get up and even get more refreshments and things if you'd like. So, demographic questions. These should be pretty straightforward. Right? Let's get through these. How old are you? All right, we have 58 responses. Closing the polling. Okay. Yeah, I didn't get a chance to look at that yet. So, residents, City of Muskegon, North Muskegon, Lake and Township, those are the communities that are on the lake itself. If you're from another community in Muskegon County, we value your opinion. We just wanted to know how many were shoreline, community members. So if you live in North Shores or Roosevelt Park or Muskegon Heights, you know, go ahead and say other community. Okay, 59. Closing the polling. Okay. All right, and employment. Do you get a paycheck from somebody else? Are you self-employed? Out of work and looking for work, out of work but not looking for work. I hope we covered it all here. This is straight from the census. All right. Okay, we'll close the polling. Here we go. Oh, wow. Look at those retired people go. All right, and your workplace, so the location of your workplace. We're at 42. We had a pretty good split. All right. And then education. Some high school diploma or GED. Some college. We lumped a few from there to end. We had to lump them even more for Al, but. I could have missed that. All right, 59 responses. There we go. And ethnicity or race. Mm-hmm. 56 responses. 58. All right. Closing the polling. There we go. I promise that I think this is the last one, maybe a couple. Okay. If you are affiliated, if you don't want to, if you're not affiliated at all and you don't want to say, you just don't have to vote on that later. Okay, we have 54, 55, 56, 58. Alright, closing the polling. Oh, we have a nice spread here. I like that. You are free to go. So it was wonderful being with you today. Thank you.
Known for their fabulous flurries, classic cones, sensational sundaes, favorite shakes and malts, banana splits, and fruit smoothies, it's Ruth Ann's Ice Cream. They also feature sandwiches, beach dogs, beverages, and Mexican favorites. Whether it's a frozen chocolate dipped banana, a slush, a float, or their ultimate espresso shake, it's Ruth Ann's Ice Cream. They make it special.
I believe that the true value of a funeral is the gathering together of people and the sharing of stories. Stories of love and honor, respect and memories. We gather together because we as human beings, we need that contact, that emotional connection that we get when we gather together. We gather together at all sorts of times, at birthdays and anniversaries, at graduations, retirements, weddings, and at funerals. And at each and every one of those gatherings, we tell stories. And it's through those stories that we show our love and respect. It's through those stories that we learn and grow. And it's through those stories that we heal. Gather together, share the stories, celebrate a life, heal the heart.
Fresh and Tasty Deli, located inside the Henry Street Health Hut, offers a variety of options for every diet. Organic, raw, vegan, vegetarian, gluten, or grain-free. You can sample specialty sandwiches, or you can build your own wrapper salad by choosing from a wide selection of fresh meats, cheeses, veggies, and dressings. From gourmet soups to smoothies, shakes, juices, herbal teas and coffee, to mouth-watering desserts, the Fresh and Tasty Deli is here to serve you.
The Butterburger is made of just three cuts of fresh Midwest beef. Nothing more, nothing less. It reminds me of the good old days when we first opened Culver's. We would call up the butcher shop and we'd buy our beef from there each and every day.
You can't get any fresher than that.
Well, today we still get fresh beef into our restaurants. We don't skimp on the quality of our beef. So we got the sirloin, the chuck, and the plate. No fillers, that's it.
All prize cuts. All well marbled for richness and flavor. And you put those all together, that ends up to be a very high quality burger.
This is where those three wonderful cuts of beef come together.
You can just tell that blend is working in there.
And we sear them, and that seals in the juices of the burger. And that's where that wonderful steak taste comes from.
It doesn't get any better than that.
You know, all our burgers are cooked to order, but that's a little different than most of our competitors. The Culver's Butter Burger.
Craig, that is one great burger.
Welcome to Delicious.